Good morning, students. Today you're going to learn about the history lesson, Unit 2, Ancient Civilization. What do you mean by ancient? Ancient means very old. What is a civilization? Civilization means advancement. In those days, human beings started developing their culture. They started settling in groups and they developed socially, so they started civilizations. Where these civilizations flourished? These civilizations flourished near rivers. So all the civilizations mostly are called as river valley civilizations. In the previous lesson, you have learnt about the prehistoric and the historic period. What is this prehistoric period? Prehistoric period is a period where there are no written evidences. Yes, early human beings were there, so they did not develop the art of writing, so no written evidences. Now, how do we come to know about these prehistoric people? Archaeologists have excavated the ruins. They have found from these ruins, they have gathered the information and they have found about the prehistoric people. So what did they find about the prehistoric people? They found bones, artifacts, the vessels they used, the instruments, all the other things that were found by them. So from that evidence, archaeologists found about the prehistoric people. Historic period consists of written evidences. Now, what are these written evidences? In the prehistoric period, people did not know how to read or write. In the historic period, they found out the art of writing. Each and every civilization had their own form of writing. So written evidences, so documents were there. Sometimes they used to write on leaves. Paper was found, so they started writing on paper. So the historic period consists of all the written documents. So from that we come to know about the historic period. Apart from that, fossils were found, stone tools, artifacts. So from that we come to know about the historic period. The prehistoric period consists of the lithic assemblages. What do you mean by lithic? Lithic means stones. So those people found out the different methods of using stones, stone tools, how they made in the beginning, how they made weapons and utensils out of stones, and slowly they started developing the technology. So it is called as lithic assemblages. So we have three types: Paleolithic, Mesolithic and Neolithic. Paleolithic from the year 8000 BC, Mesolithic 1300 BC, Neolithic 1000 BC, and we have the Megalithic 500 BC. Now what is this BC? Usually the years are recorded by the historians using the terms BC and AD. BC means before the death of Christ, AD means after the death of Christ. Prehistoric period mostly consists of the BC era. Historic period, we have the Sangam age from the year 300 AD. During the Sangam age, three important kings were there: the Cheras, Cholas and the Pandyas. The beginning of history writing can be traced to the ancient Greeks, and Herodotus is considered as the father of history. You might have learnt about the origin of humans. Humans, how was this possible? How did we find about the origin of humans? First, it was possible because of archaeological remains. So archaeologists excavated the ruins. They found all the fossils, the bones, all that was remaining. And they found out the information. Geology. Then Darwin's theory. Darwin's theory, here it means biological evolution, how human beings evolved from the lowest form, and they theory of evolution according to Darwin. Then the discovery of human and animal fossils. What are fossils? All the dead and decayed animal and plant matter got submerged or got deposited on the land. Slowly, after so many years, it got deposited under the layer of the earth. It was embedded along with the rocks and the soil, and it became fossils. So from the fossils of the human and animals that was excavated, origin of humans was traced. Apart from that, artifacts is also another factor. What are these artifacts? All the objects made by humans that was buried under the earth during all these civilizations was found out. So from all these, origin of humans was traced. Human ancestors are divided into various species according to their physical features. So it was hominid, hominins, Homo erectus, Homo habilis, and Homo sapiens. And Homo sapiens are the most modern human beings whom we see today. So they are called as modern humans. Modern human emerged some 3 lakh years ago in Africa. From Africa, they started moving toward the different parts of the world, and they settled throughout. So that is how civilization started springing up. As a result of human evolution, modern humans first appeared in Africa, and they started moving to various parts. So how did human beings became civilized? Human beings discovered fire, then invention of wheel was done. With the help of the wheel, pots were made out. So utensils were made out of pot, fire was available, so started cooking. Till then, cooking was not known. So discovery of fire and invention of wheel was a very important turning point in the prehistoric period. Then people started wearing clothes. So tools were made out of carving. They started to paint on the caves of the walls. Then small or minute needles were made out of stones. Spears were made, and all this enabled the human beings to become a transitional stage from the caveman to the next stage. Finally, that is the Neolithic period or the New Stone Age marked the beginning of the advancement of the human beings. So, agriculture was done. Yes, so this was the beginning of the development of all the civilizations. Where was all these civilizations? Near the rivers. Rivers played a very important role. For all the civilizations in the world, the rivers settlement, it's called as river settlement also. Now, this water was a reliable source for drinking, for agriculture, then transportation, fishing in the rivers. And the soil used to be fertile because every now and then flooding occurred. So the soil was fertile, so human beings started agriculture. So agriculture is the first occupation done by humans. Now, what are the different characteristics of a civilization? People started doing agriculture, they started settling. So, settlements were formed. So, there was a lot of population near the rivers. Then, people started practicing different types of work. So, based on the occupation they were doing, they were divided into groups. So, there was a division of people into social and economic class. Division of labor was also done. And people started communicating. Then territories were formed. So there were different types of administration. Administration strategies were there, different for the different type of territories. And in the field of art and architecture, there were different styles. Monuments were built, palaces were constructed. So from all that, we come to know about the advancement of a particular civilization. So what is a civilization? It is a human society with its own social organization and culture. So in many parts of the world, people started forming groups and settled in the river banks. Agriculture and trade were the most important ones for the civilization. All the civilizations, they had trade communications with each other by either by land route or sea route. So civilization started in the great river valleys, for example Mesopotamia, Egyptian, Chinese and the Indus. So we are going to learn about the four important civilizations in the world: Mesopotamian, Egyptian, Chinese and the Indus. So with the beginning of civilization, the hunter-gatherer mode was no more. So people started cultivating crops. Agriculture was the main occupation. Food production was in surplus. So they started trading with each other, either by land or sea route. People started trading with each other. So all the four civilizations, they had trade communications with each other. How do we come to know about that? When these places were excavated, archaeologists found seals, pots, utensils, agricultural implements, artifacts belonging to each and every civilization in all the other places. For example, in Egypt, in Indus Valley civilization, seals were found, coins were found. So from that we come to know all these civilizations had trade connections with each other. So we are going to learn about the Egyptian civilization first. So the river Nile in Egypt is the longest river. Where is Egypt? Egypt is in Africa. So Egypt is in Africa, in the northernmost part, and the river Nile originates from Lake Victoria and drains into the sea. This Egypt is bound by Mediterranean and the Red Sea. Both the sides of the river Nile is a desert. Only the places near the river was fertile. So it is one of the oldest civilizations in the world. And what comes to your mind whenever you hear about Egyptian civilization is the great pyramids, the Sphinx, about the mummies, isn't it? So they were famous and they were highly advanced group of people. Egypt is irrigated by the river Nile, and both the deserts, that is on the east and the west, they depended solely upon the river Nile for agriculture. So Egypt is called as the gift of Nile by the historians. It's called as the gift of Nile. It also served as a means of transport. Because it is the longest river, transport from one place to the other was very easy. Every year there was flooding in the river Nile, so fresh deposits of alluvium was there along the banks of the river, which facilitated agriculture. Because agriculture developed, people started growing different types of crops and there was surplus food. So the surplus food was sold to the other civilization people. So people started buying and selling. It became intimately connected with the Sangam age, that is in India. So trades was done between the Egyptian civilization and the Sangam age people. Now in Egypt we have the pharaohs. Pharaohs were the kings and they were considered as divine. Below the pharaohs were the viziers, the artisans, the governors, the viziers were the one who were responsible for the administration with the help of the pharaohs. Land belonged to the king and the work was divided among the viziers, and there were different officers who assisted the viziers. The artisan group consisted of the potters, weavers, masons, peasant workers, and the important practice, the Egyptians' practice was mummification. What is this mummification? The dead bodies of the kings were preserved in the pyramids. It was a procedure only known by the Egyptians. The preserved dead body is called the mummy. They preserve the dead bodies with the help of the natron salt. After the 40 days of preserving the body with the salt, then the body was covered with linen cloth and placed in a coffin called sarcophagus. The archaeologists have found out many sarcophagus in the pyramids. For example, King Tutankhamun's sarcophagus was found in the pyramid in Cairo, and it is a famous one because it has a mask made out of gold and precious stones. So when they found out these mummies, the archaeologists were astonished to see the most advanced way of preserving the dead bodies. So the Egyptians are well known for mummification. Even now these bodies are still preserved in the museums. The Egyptians cultivated wheat, barley, millets and other vegetables, and they also found out or they grew papyrus, a reed from which paper was made. So it is a remarkable one, papyrus, out of which paper was made. They domesticated cattle, sheep, goats, and they hunted wild animals. They also had pet dogs such as cats, dogs, and monkeys. And they acquired precious stones from other places. For example, Afghanistan. They got lapis lazuli, a precious stone of bluish color. In the field of art and architecture, the Egyptians are famous for their art and writing. All these paintings and writings were there found in the pyramids. From this we come to know about the artistic skills of the Egyptians. In the pyramids near Cairo, known as the Giza pyramid, all these paintings are found. Other than this, Egypt is famous for the Great Sphinx of Giza. It is a massive stone structure made out of limestone. It is a massive figure in the world, nearly some 73 meters in length and 20 meters in height. It has a body of a lion and the face of a human being. These Egyptians had their own practice in religion. They practiced polytheism. What is polytheism? Polytheism is a practice of praying to many gods and goddesses. So they worshipped Amun, Re, Seth, Horus, Anubis. These are some of the gods, and they worshipped the sun god Re. It was also called as Amun. In the field of philosophy, science and literature, the Egyptians excelled. They found out the measuring system, and they found out the sundial through which the time was calculated. So they devised a solar calendar according to the movement of the sun. So 12 months and 30 days calculation was found out by the Egyptians. Apart from this, the Egyptians were also excelling in painting, art, pottery and weaving. And they had a special type of writing system called hieroglyphic. From the excavations, it was found out how they wrote in clay tablets, otherwise in paper also. This hieroglyphics is a special form of writing. Sometimes they used to inscribe on seals and other objects as well. You can see the picture of hieroglyphic on a Rosetta Stone. Now, apart from this, what are the other contributions the Egyptians gave to the entire world? They gave the solar calendar, and the pyramids construction and their designs show their mathematics skills and engineering skills. Hieroglyphic system is a system used with the handling of symbols. And mummification is a process unknown to the entire world. Only the Egyptians are excelled in mummification. They applied the innovation in the use of science and technology. Other important contribution is the paper. Paper is reed from which a paper was made, so they started writing on paper. Till then, they were writing on stone and clay tablets. So, Egyptian civilization is one of the oldest civilization, and it is known for its monumental art and architecture. It became intimately connected with the Sangam age Tamilagam by the sea route. Numerous sculptures and paintings are found in Egypt. So from that we come to know about the advanced technology of the Egyptians. So with that we come to the end of the lesson.